Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's episode of Toby's Tech Talk. Today is Wednesday, April 2nd, 2014, and this is episode 29. So maybe next month we'll do something special for episode 30. See Gary. Hello, Gary. Typing into the question and answer block, giving me a little shout out here. So hello, how are you? Great to hear from you again. And of course, if anybody else wants to say hello, always happy to give all my friends at Toby's Tech Talk a shout out. Feel free to enter that in right over in the question and answer block. We're going to go through the typical agenda today for our 1 hour webinar. It's going to start out with the introduction. We're going to go through the tech alert, talk about some Prism SolidWorks news, and then we'll have the monthly anagram contest, and then we'll finish off with our SolidWorks demo, talking about some of the different advanced mates that show up in SolidWorks. I also always like to start Toby's Tech Talks with a quick tip just to kind of get us started, get the brain flowing a little bit. So today our quick tip is going to be on the topic of instant 3D, using instant 3D in SolidWorks. So this is a function that's turned on by default whenever you're working in SolidWorks, and I think it's important that people at least know what it is, why it's turned on, and you know how to use it, how and when to use it. Most of the time I have it turned off, but there are times when it's good to have instant 3D turned on. So with that, before we get started, I just want to do a quick poll here to make sure everybody can hear me. I am getting feedback from GoToWebinar indicating that everyone can, but let me just launch this here real quick. I am using a different webcam, different mic today, so you guys know me. I always like to mix it up a little bit. Okay, good. Getting some good feedback here. Looks like for the most part people are in fact able to hear me, and I see there's still some people coming into the webinar, so you know, feel free to fill out this poll. Let me know that you can hear me. Hello, Victor, how are you? Thank you very much for coming in today. Okay, great. I think that's enough time on that poll. Good that everybody can hear me. Sounds like I sound pretty good with this mic and this webcam, so that's great. The lighting is a little bit weird with this webcam, but I think we're going to be okay getting through this this webinar today. Video's a little choppy. Okay, good to know. Thanks, Michael. I'll see if I can do anything about that moving forward. All right, so I'm going to go to another quick poll here. And I'm going to say, how many people actually know about Instant 3D? So just kind of, you know, if somebody said, do you know about Instant 3D? Hey, do you use Instant 3D in SolidWorks? What would you say? Would you say, yeah, I use it all the time? Or would you say, no, I don't like it? Or would you say, I don't even know what that is? Well, if your answer is, I don't even know what that is, then you're answering the poll correctly. Actually, it's interesting. The majority of the people are not familiar with Instant 3D. So this is good, great feedback. Here, I'll show you guys the results of this poll. I'll share this with the group here. You can see that the majority of the people, about 80% of the attendees voted, and most of the people are actually not familiar with Instant 3D. So that's great. This is a great topic then for us to go over here as our quick tip in Toby's Tech Talk. So let's take a look here at SolidWorks. And I'm going to say new, and I'll go to the out-of-the-box part. It's basically the out-of-the-box part. And I'm going to go top plane, begin a sketch, orient my view. I press the S key on my keyboard, and I sketch a rectangle. And I'm not going to put any dimensions on it. And this is the out-of-the-box setting for SolidWorks. When you go to the tab, it says Features. There's an icon here that says Instant 3D. And that is turned on by default. Now, what are some of the things that Instant 3D is going to do? Let me just move this out of the way a little bit here. Well, Instant 3D is a technique you can use to push and pull geometry just using your mouse. That's the point of Instant 3D, is to be able to just grab geometry, push it, pull it, watch it morph right on the screen. But there are some other things that will happen with Instant 3D. And one of the biggest ones is when you double click, when you take your mouse and you click twice, and you're not over any entities, what happens is you're taken out of sketch mode. So here you can see with Instant 3D turned on, when I double click, I'm taken out of sketch mode. And when I then double click on a gray sketch entity, I'm automatically put back into edit sketch mode. So that's definitely going to be a big difference you're going to notice when you're working with Instant 3D compared to not working with Instant 3D, and where that could come up and maybe be a little frustrating. And maybe if you didn't know what Instant 3D was, maybe this will answer some of your questions. Here I've got this dimension, 90, and I'm going to go over here. Let's see, I'm going to double click on this dimension because I want to change it. And what just happened? I just got kicked out of the sketch. Why did I get kicked out of the sketch? It's because Instant 3D is turned on. It's on your features toolbar. It's right here on your features toolbar. And it's turned on by default. So what happened was I meant to double click the dimension, but I missed it. I double click the background and I get kicked out of the sketch. Now another thing that happens with Instant 3D turned on is that you can single click on a gray sketch and you can see this green arrow shows up and you can grab that arrow and drag it up. And you can see when I take that arrow and I drag it up, I'm able to actually turn that into solid geometry. It's kind of cool. If I put my mouse over the ruler, then my increments will snap to those ruler increments. So now this should be exactly 50 high. And yes, I can click on that model and I can see the dimensions. And that's going to be a single click on that model. When I single click, so I just click once, all the dimensions show up. You get all those dimensions, you get the 90, you get the 50, all the dimensions you use to create that feature show up. If I wanted to resize the height of this, I can grab this green arrow and drag it down, snap it into place. But if I wanted to resize the depth of this extrusion, I'm not going to be able to do it. And when I go to grab this arrow and move it, I'm actually relocating all of the geometry. I'm not actually resizing it. I'm relocating the whole thing. Okay, if I had fully defined this sketch, or at least put a few more constraints on it, so let's say I make this guy here a midpoint. Now what's going to happen is, if I click on this end face here, the one that is not constrained, I'll be able to grab that end face and drag it in either direction, and you can see here everything's good. But if I click this face here, I'm not able to drag it. It says feature sketch is constrained in this direction. It cannot be dragged. So what we can do is we can hold our cursor over this little blue orb here. At the end of your dimension, you're going to have this blue orb. And I can click on that blue orb and drag it. And when I click on that blue orb and I drag it, then I can resize the geometry in that direction. So basically the workflow is you select a face, begin a sketch, S key, sketch your geometry, maybe put a dimension on it. Then you can double click in the background. That's going to let you exit the sketch. Then you can single click on that sketch entity again and you can drag it up. And there you go. Now you've got 3D geometry. If you hold your cursor over one of these entities here, you can position it to the appropriate height. If you then go back and you single click on some geometry, you can resize it. Maybe I could resize this by grabbing this blue orb. Or I could maybe resize the diameter by grabbing this blue orb here. Again, I can snap to the ruler. Or you could relocate it, and relocating is going to happen here with these arrows in the middle. So I can take this geometry and I can relocate it. Like so. One thing that you can do with Instant 3D that I don't think you can do with just a regular SolidWorks command is you can, with Instant 3D, turn this extrusion into a cut. So if I click on this face here and I grab this arrow and drag it down into the model, you'll see that actually changes it from being an extrusion to a cut. It'll even change the name in the tree, which is kind of interesting. So you can see here in the tree, you've got the cut extrude 2. In the tree instead of it being a boss extrude, and then if I grab this dimension and drag it back up the other way, it changes it to boss extrude 2. That's something that you're not really going to be able to do with a standard command. So a question came in here, most of our stuff is revolved. This question is from Michael. Most of our stuff is revolved. Can you do that quickly? That's a great question. Let's take a look. So I'm going to create just a really simple shape here for this revolve. I'll create a rectangle like so, and then I'll maybe get rid of some of this geometry, have it kind of come down at an angle, and then I'll close that thing off like so. And then we'll just drop in a quick center line here, even though I know we could revolve around that. So now I'm going to double click in the background. And then let's see what can I do here. If I click on that line, that's still going to put me into an extrude. That's not what we want. So I guess my answer, Michael, is not that I know of with Instant 3D. I think it's really just for push-pull type of geometry. I don't know of a way to take it and revolve it, but I'll see if I can't research that for you. And, you know, like always, in a spot like this where I don't know the answer, rather than, you know, just kind of give you an answer that's ambiguous, like, maybe you can. A lot of times what I like to do is actually go and search it at the knowledge base. So here we are at SolidWorks.com. I'm in the customer portal. And then I'm going to go... I just want to show everybody the home screen just in case you're not familiar with the home screen. So here's the home screen of the customer portal. And then there's a link here for knowledge base. And so then I'll type instant 3D revolve. Any diameter, dimension, and revolve sketch, not move it. The rotational axis, this has been known, to temporarily turn off. So that's just an SPR, just another SPR there. Diameter dimensions from a revolve are displayed incorrectly after editing them with the sketch. So, yeah, there's not much in here for instant 3D with revolve. The other place you can go, whether you go to it on the web or from your, you know, from your local SolidWorks, but on the web you can go to help.solidworks.com. That's the online portal to the SolidWorks help page. You could go to the SolidWorks help page here and then maybe run a quick search, or you know, just look for instant 3D. I probably would search here instant 3D. See what we come up with. No matches found. Did I spell it wrong? Instant 3D. No, I spelled it correct. So maybe this. Okay. So it's all one word. So maybe if I go back to the knowledge base and search it with one word. No, I'm still just getting the same hits on that. And then we could go to, you know, parts and features or just instant 3D here. And let's see if we can't find out some creating features with Instant 3D. Instant 3D lets you drag and drop geometry to create feature sketch. The geometry for a boss cut or boss extrude, then exit sketch. Select the sketch contour, grab the handle. So, yep, I think there's your answer, Michael. Great question. You know, like I said, when we're doing Toby's Tech Talk and you ask a question like this, it does kind of give you a chance to see inside, you know, how we work in tech support. These would be the types of things we'd do. First, we would just try it. You know, maybe we can just figure it out by going through the user interface. Then we would go to the knowledge base, search it on the knowledge base. Use less words when you're searching. You don't want to say, is it possible for me to create a revolve in instant 3D? Instead, you want to just instant 3D revolve. What do we come up with? We just came up with a couple SPRs, okay? Let's go to the help file or help.solidworks.com, search there, and it looks like in the help it's saying you can only do bosses and extrudes. But great question. I like that question, yeah. So what is the point of instant 3D? Well, instant 3D is really good if you've got a customer or a boss shouldering you and they say, you know, what if we made that a little bit shorter? You could just take this thing and drag it down and make it shorter. See, traditionally in SolidWorks, what you're going to have to do is double-click the boss, double-click the dimension, type in the new value, enter, and then rebuild. Or maybe use rebuild in that box. But it's still kind of a multi-step process. And especially somebody who's less familiar with SolidWorks, they might wonder, why is it so many steps? Well, with Instant 3D turned on, you can really kind of show them what's going on with the design and show them how, you know, that the changes you're making are going to affect the design. Another great place to use Instant 3D is with lofts and sweeps. So here what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold control on my keyboard and drag this plane out. And I'm going to indicate that I want two copies of that plane. And then here on plane one, I'm going to create a rectangle. Let's say I'll put a dimension on that for height, but not for the width. And then what I'll do is I'll just center that as well. So I'll drop a center line in here and make that, you know, coincident to the origin. And then here on plane two, well, I'll just take that sketch, control C, and then I'll control V, paste it onto plane two. So control C, control V to get that on there. Now, usually when you do that, it doesn't pick up the relationship. So I'll probably have to still edit the sketch and add the relationship. So I'll double click because I'm in instant 3D, and I'll just make sure that that relationship gets added as well. It's what's called an external relationship, external to the sketch. Now I'm going to do a loft. Okay, and now when I single click on the face of the loft, I get all these dimensions, but I also get the sketch geometry here. And so what that enables me to do is, using Instant 3D, just kind of push-pull that sketch geometry and examine what the results are. And you see, as soon as I let go of the sketch, it updates. So again, if you're working with a customer or working with a boss who's maybe not as familiar with, you know, some of the different functionality of SolidWorks, this can be a really good way for them to see right away, right on the fly, you know, what is happening with this design. What would happen if we change this plane to be located a little more in the center? You know, and you can see that as we make that change, we can look down on this from the top and we can see right away what the effect of that change is. So it's a really nice way to show those kinds of dynamic changes. But beyond that, I'm going to have it turned off. And the reason I have it turned off is because it just feels a little too easy to make those changes. For example, if I wanted to relocate this dimension, you know, move it over here, maybe I want to move it over here instead, I might accidentally grab the dimension and make a change to it. And I don't want that to happen. It's just a little too easy to make changes. So I don't want that to happen. So Instant 3D is good. It has its place, that's for sure. You know, push-pull geometry. But, you know, it might not be something you want turned on all the time. The workflow with Instant 3D is definitely going to feel simpler. So it's great when you're showing your bosses or showing your customers. For example, with Instant 3D turned on to change the height of this, I could also single-click the boss, single-click the dimension, type the new value and press enter. With Instant 3D turned off, that process is going to be a few more steps. I'm going to double click the boss, double click the dimension, type in the new value, and then either hit rebuild here or press enter and then rebuild afterwards. With Instant 3D turned on, when you single click a boss, you get all of this feedback, you get all the dimensions, all these little arrows. It's a little bit busy in my opinion, there's a lot going on. If it's this loft example, and I single click the loft, I get the dimensions for the planes that were used for the loft, the height of each profile, you know, all the dimensions all the way across. If Instant 3D is turned off, you must double click to get that information, and sometimes that can make things a little bit clearer, especially if you're adding colors. You know, I want to add a color to this face. I don't want to see all these dimensions. I'm just trying to change the color of that face. So then why spend so much time in Toby's Tech Talk talking about this? Well, because a lot of people don't know what it is, and because it is turned on out of the box. When you install SolidWorks, it is turned on. So it's good to know, you know, maybe why you're getting certain functionality and what the difference is, what's causing it. And, you know, a lot of people didn't know about it. So for those people, I hope this was really helpful. For those who did know about it, I hope you got maybe to see something a little bit cool. You know, lastly, just because it's really hard for me to resist showing this, we always show this in demos, even though it has just about no practical application. Here you can see I'm going to relocate this boss here just a little bit. I'm going to throw a fillet on this boss. So I'm going to relocate it just by dragging that little control handle there. I'm going to throw a fillet on this by single clicking an edge and then clicking fillet from my shortcut menu. Type in the value for that. And then finally, I'm going to use Instant 3D to take this boss and turn it into a cut. And look at that, the fillet reverses as I do that. Is that so cool or what? I love showing that. I think it looks really cool. I admit I have never once used that in production, but it looks really cool. Keep this in mind though, if you're ever working in SolidWorks and you're in the zone, right? You've created your geometry, you're ready now to create a cut extrude down 15 millimeters. So you select a face, begin a sketch, orient your view, you select the circle command, you type in your diameter, exit sketch, you go to extrude that, so you've got your sketch here, you go to extrude it 15 millimeters, and then you realize after the fact, oh man, I wanted that to be a cut extrude to 15 millimeters. Well, what you could do is you could turn on Instant 3D, single click up top here, and then drag that guy down, use a little ruler here so you get right at 15, and then you're ready to proceed. You don't have to delete the feature and then recreate it any longer. Cool. If there's any questions, feel free, fire them in. Otherwise, we're going to proceed with Toby's Tech Talk. I hope you guys found that useful, though. And like I said, a lot of people don't know what Instant 3D is and how it, you know, could affect you. And hopefully now you'll know when you see all those dimensions pop up. Oh, Instant 3D is turned on. Just turn that off on the Features toolbar. Tony says, I like the way the cut changes in the model tree. Yeah, I think it's kind of cool. It actually renames it in the tree. I was surprised by that. Okay, my name is Toby Schnars. I work for Prism Engineering, the best reseller in the world, and we are located in the Mid-Atlantic area. I am a SolidWorks elite applications engineer, which is just to say I have a lot of certifications. I've taught a lot of classes, contributed a lot to the user community. Recently, SolidWorks has been kind of changing the way that these badges show up. So now when you see these badges, it might look a little bit more like this. So if you take your CSWP or CSWA or CSWE, you'll get a badge like this, and you can put in your signature, use it in your collateral, things like that. And these are all the ones I have. A lot of that's tech support and training and stuff like that. Did you know, I always mention this, I will not belabor this too much because I mention it every month, but I do get requests every month. So if there's any new attendees of Toby's Tech Talk this month, you can actually get a full copy of SolidWorks. You can download the whole thing. So you can download a full copy of 2012. Actually, I think it's only 13 and 14 now. I think they might have pulled 12. Again, rather than being ambiguous, let me go back here to the SolidWorks customer portal. And on the customer portal, I'm going to say downloads and updates. And then I'm going to pull down this menu here, and you can see, yep, only 13 and 14 are available now for the full download. So 13 and 14, you know, make sure you get a copy of it before they pull 13, but they'll probably leave that up there for a couple of years. Full download available at SolidWorks.com. Email me, swtech@prismeng.com, if you want to find out how to do it. When you get a copy of that full download, what you'll be left with is what I'm showing here in my Z drive, which is a folder that contains everything on the DVD. For 2014, it's 7.75 gig, and that's because the install for 2014 encompasses SolidWorks Electrical, which is our SolidWorks Electrical schematic package, and SolidWorks Composer, our marketing tool. So, you know, that's why that DVD is a little bit larger. There's also a video you can watch at our Prism Engineering YouTube page on how to do the install with some great tips and tricks. And it's a wonderful video. Hope you guys enjoy watching it. Very handsome presenter too. Last month we had an anagram contest, and that was Birds and Nest. And we were talking about sheet metal last month, and that's why we had this one. And so the answer to that one was Insert Bends. So anagram contest runs every month. At the end of the year, we'll have some lucky winners, or I shouldn't say lucky, some deserved winners. The people who have answered the most correct anagrams throughout the year will receive a gift card. I believe it's a $100 gift card. So good luck to everybody. You know, keep sending those submissions in, and we'll show you the one for this month in just a couple slides. There's a workgroup EPDM issue. I talked about this last month. I just want to mention it again. It's been resolved in SP2. It was preventing workgroup EPDM users from checking Word documents and you know, PowerPoints, things like that, into the vault. I mean, when you get a vault system, whether it's enterprise or workgroup EPDM, just keep that in mind. Whatever projects you're working on, you know, a lot of times I'll do Prism Engineering presentations, and for those presentations, I'll include additional file types. Like here, this is a PNG here that I created of a rendering. So we can include those different file types inside the vault, and there's nothing that stops you from opening those. This was just a rendering, a JPEG. But it may also be a PowerPoint. When we went to SolidWorks this year, I did a presentation on SolidWorks and surface modeling, and so I included the PowerPoint inside of the vault here. And that way I've got a running copy of that PowerPoint, and as I make changes to it, you know, I can access those changes and I can see those changes in the vault. But you know, just keep that in mind, whether you're using enterprise or whether you're using workgroup, you can check non-SolidWorks documents into the vault. And in this case, there was an issue with checking Office documents in, like Word, PowerPoint, Excel. It's been resolved, but if you're using workgroup EPDM in 2014, just make sure you get up to SP2. SP2 came out a couple of months ago. And I mentioned this also last month, but just so that you're aware, if you're using a 32-bit system, like 32-bit Windows 7, SolidWorks will no longer run on 32-bit systems starting with 2015. So, you know, just it's probably time. You know, I'm using a 64-bit system here. Let's see what I'm using as far as RAM goes. So I'm using 3.7 gig. So if I had a 32-bit system with the maximum amount of RAM that I could utilize, I'd be just about maxing it out, because you can only get 4 gig of RAM into a 32-bit system. So I would be, you know, I would really be maxing it out even just doing what I'm doing right now, you know, running SolidWorks and recording the webinar. So you could imagine if you're doing a large assembly, something like that, you know, it just makes sense. You want to start thinking about it now, what it's going to take to get up to a 64-bit system. I mean, as far as what we recommend, Windows 7 64-bit, 8 gig of RAM or more, a supported graphics card. You know, you can see a list of those supported graphics cards at the SolidWorks website. This you can get to right at SolidWorks.com. You don't even have to go into the customer portal. You just go to SolidWorks.com, come down to the bottom and click support. And then you can click system requirements. And then there's a link right here, right on the system requirements page, to the graphics card drivers, where you can look up your computer, you can look up your driver, the version of SolidWorks you're trying to use, and you can find out whether or not that's supported. So for me, it's a Dell M4600, that's a laptop. And I've got the Quadro 2000M in there, the NVIDIA card, and I'm trying to run SolidWorks 2014 on Windows 7 64-bit. So it looks like I've got a driver here that passed all tests, supports all RealView features, and has native 64-bit support. That's good. I mean, the driver that's listed here is going to work for me, as long as I have that driver running. You know, that's the other part of the puzzle. But it's a good place to go to find out if you have a supported card. And then optionally, or optimally, that's what I like to say now, solid-state hard drive is going to make a huge difference, especially when you're moving files around, whether it's from an EPDM vault into your local cache or even just doing local file management. It's going to make a big deal. I mentioned a couple slides ago, SP2 was released back in January, so January 28th. So if you're running SolidWorks 2014, be sure to get up to SP2. Again, remember, you can do the full download, and that's really useful for a number of reasons that are outlined in that document. But you know, the biggest one would be one person could download it and then just share it with everybody in the department. You know, you can even download it at home and bring it in on a hard drive, even a flash drive, you know, 16 gig flash drive, bring it in and share it with all your coworkers. So. A question here came in from Eric. The question is there a recommended CPU spec? Yeah, it's a great question, Eric. There is a recommended CPU spec. It's at SolidWorks.com. So let's take a look here. So we go SolidWorks system requirements, and then we've got minimum hardware. Actually, I guess there's not a recommended. We've got minimum hardware here, and you can see here in minimum hardware the processor that's listed, some different minimum. You know, and as long as you meet these minimum requirements, you know, the faster, stronger, better CPU, you know, the better. But there are certainly concerns, like if you're doing a lot of motion analysis versus doing a lot of finite element analysis versus doing a lot of photo rendering, you know, what's going to be better for you? Is it going to be better to have a single processor? Is it going to be better to have multiple processors? And it's really hard. It's really a difficult question to answer, or really a difficult question to stay on top of. It's what we do here at Prism Engineering is a lot of application support. We don't do a lot of hardware support. So I admit that it's definitely not in my, you know, my personal wheelhouse as far as you know, giving those recommendations or citing the reasons behind those recommendations. But fortunately, you got a lot of support, and you can go on to the SolidWorks forums. You know, you can see in the SolidWorks forums and just kind of look up like what's better or hardware recommendations. You can go to websites like SolidMuse. You can go to Anna Wood's website. She's got a lot of good stuff on hardware recommendations and what's better, whether, you know, you're doing photo rendering or whether you're doing FEA. You know, it changes. It really changes rapidly. You know, probably every 6 months there's going to be something new out that's going to change the game, that's going to change the recommendations and things like that. So, you know, there's some really good resources. If you need some help tracking down those resources, you can email me, you know, in support, swtech@prismeng.com. I can certainly help you track down those resources. But it's probably not something that I'm going to know, or even that we're going to know at Prism, just because, believe it or not, it's a little bit outside of the realm of what we do. We do a lot of application support, which means we understand how the software works. And certainly, you know, if there were any customers that had this question, we could help them research it. We could find the answer for you. But to know the answer right off the top of my head, I don't know it. I'll admit it. It's something that I have a difficult time keeping up with because it changes so much. And because, you know, it's like I said, we spend a lot of time teaching how to use the SolidWorks software, how to troubleshoot, how to find answers within the SolidWorks software. But we actually don't spend that much time doing hardware support anymore. It doesn't come up as much as it used to. I guess because the technology is moving so quickly, and because, you know, you get a computer and what you get is so good when you get it. It kind of lasts for a long time. Even though new technologies are coming out, it's still what you get, you know, lasts you longer, and there's not as much a need to update. But, you know, it's a valid question, like I said, Eric, and if you want to dive into it further, I can certainly give you some good resources. You know, I suppose the other resource that would be good to mention here would be My Solid Box. And not so much to necessarily buy off of them, which you certainly can buy, you know, systems from My Solid Box, but even just to look at, you know, this is what's considered a really high-end computer. What's the CPU that they're using in there? You know, they have a great team over there. I don't want this to sound like a sales pitch, but, you know, they do offer a lot of really good systems. But even if you weren't planning to go there to purchase, you could certainly take a look at what is involved in what they consider their professional bundle. You know, how do they have it spec'd out? And so, you know, when you go and you look at some of these things, maybe you could, you know, find out some more information about that too. Just trying to see if they have the actual specs. Maybe they stopped putting specs. I don't know. I know they used to have them all mapped out. I'm gonna have to look into that a little more. But certainly, you know, the forums, some different websites are going to be able to give you some really good info on that. Yeah, Eric says, I agree. The computer market tends to move much faster than the actual needs. Yeah, that's exactly it. It's, you know, it's moving so fast, but maybe the computer you have, like the computer I've had it for over 2 years now, you know, and it's still screaming. It's great. I use it for FEA. I use it for photo rendering. You know, I agree that even though the market has moved ahead and there's probably a computer that's 5 times better than this one, you know, everything that this one does is perfect for me. And I think it's probably how it is for a lot of people. Mentioned this before, but just to always like to mention it again, Windows XP is gone. The support for Windows XP stopped after 2012, so 2013 does not support Windows XP, nor does 2014. Where you can find out more news about SolidWorks, again, back to the customer portal. When you're in the customer portal at SolidWorks, you can check out over here on the right these different areas of popular solutions. And, you know, these aren't just SolidWorks solutions. Like this one here, is temperature dependent density is applied incorrectly as 1 kilometer per meter cubed. And so this is probably the SPR that's listed here for simulation or materials question. But, you know, how can I get daily technical tips from the SolidWorks technical services team? That might be a useful one. Check out our SolidWorks Care Twitter account where we tweet regularly and give tips to the SolidWorks users. So, you know, there's a lot of good stuff you can pick up over here just by going, hey, look at this, SP3 early visibility is available for download. How about that? I don't see it. Oh, here it is. No, that's not it. So maybe they're about to release it. I know I was on here earlier today and I didn't see it either. But SP3 early visibility is coming out. So you can see here, you can get some different good tips and tricks from the SolidWorks customer portal as well. Finally, I just want to mention Mechanical Conceptual. I'm not going to launch the poll, but if you haven't heard of Mechanical Conceptual, be sure to check it out. It's going to be coming down the pike pretty soon here. I think this month, actually, April of 2014 is when it's scheduled to be released. And you can find out more about what Mechanical Conceptual is, how it can help you, some other customer case studies. And basically, it's an online tool that works. It's not SolidWorks. It's a different tool that's being released from Dassault and from SolidWorks. But it's an online tool where you can do multi-user collaboration and different users can kind of draw in the same workspace at the same time. It's kind of cool. I'll let the videos do the talking for me. And you can check those out just by Googling SolidWorks Mechanical Conceptual. As far as Prism Engineering news and events, there's a number of user groups coming up really soon. You can email me for more details on these at swtech@prismeng.com. But, and of course, you could also search these user groups, and I'm sure you could find their websites as well. But the Happy Valley SolidWorks Users Group in Penn State is happening April 8th. That's next week. I'm going to be giving a lecture there. So if you happen to be in central Pennsylvania and you want to come learn a little bit about surfacing, especially users who aren't familiar with surfacing, it's Beginner Surfacing for Beginners is the name of the lecture. And this is going to take place at Penn State on April 8th, 2014. The Mid-Atlantic Users Group meeting, they meet here in Horsham, Pennsylvania, over at the Horsham Library, right down the street from the Prism office. That's going to take place April 10th, again next week. And then the South Central New Jersey SolidWorks Users Group is going to meet May 7th. and that's in Mount Laurel, New Jersey. So if you're interested in any other details on that, feel free to email me, swtech@prismeng.com. I'll be happy to share any additional details on those locations or the dates. Or like I said, you could always also search those user groups. There's an area at the SolidWorks customer portal where you can also look up users groups. So it's, let's see here, I think it's in users groups. Here it is, under community, users groups, and then you can also find a group there. So, you know, be sure to check out those users groups. There's a couple of them coming up, and they're always a great place to go to meet other users in the area, maybe network a little bit, find out, you know, hey, you're working on this, we're working on this, maybe we can do some business together. I am still working on this YouTube series. I know I haven't posted any of the videos yet. I got a little bit sidetracked. I actually got a new guitar, a new bass, so I'm considering maybe modeling that instead. It would still use reverse engineering, using photos, using layout sketch, capturing a logo, using SolidWorks Electrical, it is active, and doing some photo rendering. So kind of put that series together. Started with the amp, and then I kind of got backed off a little bit, and had a lot of people ask me from my other model, the other bass model I made, how long did that take you? And so I could also kind of do time card capturing and show you guys how you can track yourselves or track your employees using enterprise PDM or worker PDM. You could track how long it's actually taking them to get the production done. But we did manage to post a couple of new tips last month on SolidWorks on the Prism Engineering website. So a quick tip on using the S key, quick tip on using the R key. This is part of a five-part series on SolidWorks tips you should be using every day. And you'll see me using a lot of these tips as we go through the demonstration of the mates in just a couple more slides. But be sure to check out our YouTube page. You can just Google search Prism Engineering YouTube and you'll find us. You can also Google search Toby's Tech Talk and you'll find us. So let's say if I do Toby's Tech Talk, search it, it takes you right to the Tech Talk page, and then you can see some of these old ones posted, and you click on the little link here that says Prism Engineering, and that takes you to all of the Prism Engineering videos. Okay, let's see here. Another question came in. A question came in from Tony here about using mirrored assemblies versus multiple components. In the past, talk archive webinars. Have you discussed? Now, I don't think I have discussed that, Tony, and that's a good, great suggestion. In fact, the suggestion for the topic this month was provided by a user. Excuse me. And I encourage you guys to email me. You know, anytime you can email me and you can say, hey, you know, it'd be great in Toby's Tech Talk if you talked about mirrored components. It changed over the years. It used to just be a standalone part. Now they're linked together and the way they are in the folders is different. If you're working in 2010 versus 2013, you know, what's going on with mirrored components? How can we best utilize them? And is it better to have mirrored components in the assembly or is it better to have individual parts? You know, what can we do? How can we learn more about that? So email me, and I'll definitely consider that. And Tony, I'll definitely take your consideration, your suggestion under consideration as well. Maybe we can see that in an upcoming webinar. But great suggestion, mirrored components and assemblies. Okay, this month's anagram contest is going to be We That Mid. We That Mid. And the hint here is going to be get yourself centered. Get yourself centered. And if you've, you know, if you've been in Toby's Tech Talk before, you probably remember that these anagram contests usually have to do with the main topic that we're talking about. A little second hint there for you. If you can unscramble that word or those words and you can figure out what word it makes up, it's a SolidWorks term, email that to me, tschnars@prismeng.com, and I'll be sure to add you to the tally and we'll see who comes up with the most correct answers by the end of the year. Finally, the SolidWorks demo for today. Advanced Mates Part 1. Now, like I said, this came as a suggestion from one of the users in the Toby's Tech Talk community. The suggestion was, hey Toby, hope things are well. Do you take requests? If so, I'm very interested in two topics in particular. And then David went on to describe those two topics. One was working more with kinematic mates so that you can actually drag your parts in the assembly and see gear trains working within the assembly. And the other was, how would this then roll into SolidWorks Motion? And so this will probably be a three-part series. We'll probably do part one on advanced mates, which in SolidWorks, when we're talking about mates or advanced mates, what we're really referring to is Everything beyond the first section of mates, which is your standard mates. So over here on the left, you've got your standard mates: coincident, parallel, perpendicular, tangent, concentric, lock, which I might mention lock today just because not a lot of people know about it. And then you've got distance and you've got angle. Well, I'm talking about everything beyond that. So for part one, I'm going to talk about the advanced mates: symmetric, width, path mate, linear coupler, limit distance, and limit angle. And then in part two, I'll talk about the mechanical mates. So that'll be next month. I've already got a topic for next month, so thank you, David. Next month, I'll talk about cam, slot, hinge, gear, rack and pinion, screw, and universal joint. And then in 2 months, what I'd like to do is I'd like to have a special guest, Brian Morris, who is one of our top applications engineers. He's out in Pittsburgh. Be my special guest on Toby's Tech Talk and give a little demonstration of motion of how we can then go from working with those mates into SolidWorks motion, how we could size a motor appropriately, how we could determine what the different stresses are on the components you can actually output from motion and then import into SolidWorks simulation and get stress results, and how that's going to affect your design. So I'll have to talk over with Brian exactly what the agenda would be, but that's my plan for the next 3 months. We'll do advanced mates this month, we'll do mechanical mates next month, and then the following month, or maybe 2 months after that, maybe we'll take a little break from assemblies, we'll do working with SolidWorks motion and how we can get all this mate information into SolidWorks motion. So with that, let's take a look at advanced mates in SolidWorks. Like I said before, we've got symmetric, width, path, linear coupler, limit distance, limit distance and limit angle. Now, a great tip I always like to mention, and a little shout out here to my friend Roger, is that when you're working in SolidWorks, if you're in an assembly and you just hold down the control key with your finger, you can drag parts and make copies of those parts. So you don't have to go over to the tree, you don't have to do, insert component again or anything like that. You just hold control, drag, and there you go, you've got a copy of that part. You just hold control and you can drag a copy of that part. So I'm going to turn off real view graphics. I think sometimes things look a little easier to see with real view turned off. And it's still a little bit dull, so I'm going to go up here to my scene and maybe make my scene plain white. Let's see if that helps at all. Plain white, that did indeed help to lighten things up. So that's another good tip, is that you can go up to your scene here. Now you can see I've got a lot going on in 2014 with my scenes, and that's because I was doing some photo rendering and I wanted to see a lot of different options. So I went into manage favorites here and I selected everything. I said select all. Select all or deselect all. Normally you just have 3-point faded, plain white, maybe like the backdrop, soft spotlight, rooftop. Those are usually the ones you have. And so then when I go to scene up here, where did my heads up toolbar go? Let me close that. It's back. So then when I go to scene, now I've only got these guys in here. And then I can change that to plain white, and that's a good way to, help brighten up your screen a little bit. I'm going to hold control, drag a copy, hold control, drag a copy. I just want to talk briefly about the lock mate. Now, when you are working in SolidWorks, if you left click and drag, you can move parts. If you right click and drag, you can rotate parts. If you right click on a part and you choose fix, then that part will be fixed in place. This is not the same as lock. What lock is it's relative motion between two components. So when I press the S key and I go to the mate command, assembly toolbar mate, but usually I'll just press the S key and go to the mate command, I've got lock over here. Lock is relative motion between two components. So I can say this component and this component are going to be locked together. And now what happens is they'll always move together. Left click and drag to move, right click and drag to rotate. Their relative motion is locked together. So you can see, lock is a little bit different than the fix command. When you do a fix mate in SolidWorks, you don't have any motion at all. When you do a lock command, it's relative motion between two components. Okay, let's take a look at the next mate that we're going to examine here. I'm going to delete this component, which is going to delete the lock mate, and I'm going to make another copy here. I'm going to just press tab on my keyboard. Another great enhancement that was added to SolidWorks, tab. When I put my cursor over this part here and I just press tab, that part gets hidden. My cursor over this part here, tab, that part gets hidden. Pretty cool, right? Tab to hide components. And now we're going to talk about the first mate in our list, which I believe is the symmetric mate. Yep, symmetric mate. And so for the symmetric mate here, we're going to take two parts. And granted, these parts are not actually symmetric. It would require a left-hand, right-hand version. They're identical. And then we're going to go S key mate, and we're going to go into our advanced mates. And in our advanced mates, we're going to say symmetric. And when we go into symmetric, we're going to choose our plane of symmetry, which is just going to be the front plane. Oh, I'm sorry. Front plane. And we're going to choose our faces that need to maintain symmetry. So it's going to be this face and this face. So those two were planar faces, and now those planar faces are going to be, you know, move together. They're going to move with symmetry. It looks kind of funky, the symmetry, because, you know, like, what? That's not symmetry. Well, it's the plane that's acting symmetric. The angle of this plane, you know, hitting my plane of symmetry here is the same as the angle here hitting the plane. So it's the angle of that planar face. If you wanted to look more symmetric or behave more symmetric, what you would do is you would mate these two faces together, you would mate these two faces together, and now you're going to see, oh yeah, that's symmetric. They're moving together. So it's the plane of symmetry. Now, another technique that could be used with the symmetric mate command that should not be overlooked is the ability to center a component. So in that first example, we took the front plane as our plane of symmetry, and that front plane is fixed. In this example, we're going to use this plane here as our plane of symmetry. It's the right plane of this component. We're going to make this our plane of symmetry, and that plane is obviously moving. It's movable. It's not locked down at all, right? So we're going to take that right plane there, and we're going to say S key mate. We're going to say advanced mates, symmetric. And now our symmetry plane is going to be this right plane that's kind of able to float all around because it's this part that's not fixed. And then we're going to say that our mate selection here, our entities to mate, are going to be this face and this face, which are currently locked. And so now you can see you get kind of the opposite effect. That's one that's really overlooked, is that you can actually take your components and you can mate your components together using symmetry to center your components. Rather than going in and doing a with mate to get your components centered, you can use your symmetry mate and you can mate to this floating plane here, you know, with these rigid faces here, and now that component is centered, or at least its plane is centered inside. So really good, you know, really good trick there. You know, it all comes back to when you're making components, if you can intelligently center your planes, you're going to save yourself so much time on the tail end when it comes to making assemblies. So always center your planes. So a couple of notes here. Actually, it's kind of funny. These two questions go together. From Keith, he said, how did you do the quick copy of the part? And Mike says, the control shortcut to copy components is great. So that's great. Mike is answering Keith's question. So Keith, the answer is you hold down control and then you drag a copy of the part. So you can, I did it there in the graphics area, but you could also do that from the tree. I'm gonna delete this part here. I'm gonna go over to the tree, hold down control and drag a copy of that part. Hold down control and drag a copy of that part. So hope that answers your question, Keith. You're gonna probably see me doing that a lot during this presentation. And then the other new shortcut that was added in 2014 that I absolutely love is pick a face, hold control, pick another face, let go of control, and you get this little mate quick shortcut here. Now, I mentioned this in an earlier tech talk. I think it was the one on my top shortcuts of 2014, but this is awesome. You don't have to click mate or click a check mark, click anything. You just click concentric, and boom, they're brought together. So that's a really awesome shortcut for 2014. Okay, I'm gonna get rid of this one. I'm gonna do that again right here. I'm gonna take this face, hold control, pick this face, let go of control, and make them parallel. And now we got that guy centered. And then I'm gonna bring another copy of this red part in, and I'm gonna pick this face, hold control, pick this face here, let go of control, make them concentric. And now what I need to do is I need to center this red part inside. And I don't have a plane that I can use to center that part inside. So this is where we need to move on to the next mate type, which is gonna be the with mate. So I'm going to go S key mate, advanced mates, width, and I'm going to say there's going to be a width mate here between two faces of one component, and two faces of another component. And the two faces of one component are then going to be centered about the two faces of the other component. Let me just do that again, just so you guys can see. It doesn't matter what selections you make for either end. So I'm going to go S key mate, I'm going to go advanced mates width, and I'm going to pick two faces off this component. This time I'm going to use select other. So I'm going to right click, select other, and I'm going to pick through. Okay, and that way I don't have to, there's actually a couple of advantages there. That, you know, first of all, I don't have to rotate the parts, which is nice. But the other advantage is that the other advantage is that these two guys here, once I pick that second face, it automatically advanced down to the second row. So it's really a nice feature. If I pick this face here, I right click, I do select other, pick this face here, it automatically advanced me over here in the box. So that's the other nice use of select other. So I pick this face here, right click, I do select other to get this face on the back, pick that face. And you can see that the two faces that I selected are centered about the two faces I selected. It doesn't matter if the wider faces go above or the smaller faces go below. That's the width mate. Again, if you can, center your parts. Okay, centering your parts is going to be less taxing on SolidWorks. Use mates, coincident to coincident. There's no math that has to be done. If you're using width, it's fine, you can use it, but there is going to be some math that has to be done by the software, and if you're doing a lot of mates, it's going to slow you down. Okay, let's take a look at some other pretty cool mates that are in the software in the advanced mate section. This next one I really like, the path mate command. This is really a cool one. So here I'm going to open up an assembly. This is an assembly of a house, you can see. I'm going to take my mouse out on the screen, and I'm going to, when I bring my mouse out on the screen, I'm going to press tab. And you can see that gets rid of some of that geometry. And then I'm gonna press the R key. And in 2014, when we're looking at our recently used documents, we can drag from the R key and just drop right out here on the screen. It's really cool. You don't have to use insert component anymore or anything like that. Tab, it's gonna hide. I'm gonna press tab over here, that's gonna hide. Now I'm using control tab to go back to my assembly. Now here on this face, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna begin a sketch, and I'm gonna create a sketch of a line. And this line is going to then turn into an arc. So I'm clicking the line command. I'm going to the endpoint of the line. And then what I'm doing is I'm coming back and touching the endpoint with my mouse. And that's putting me into an arc command. And then I'll create a shape like that. So this could just as easily, if you imagine a conveyor system, you know, a series of conveyor belts that are butted up against one another, you could just create this sketch on the top of those conveyors. I'm going to exit that sketch. And now I'm going to create a mate. I'm going to do S key, mate, advanced mates, and this is going to be my path mate. And when I go to create the path mate, I'm going to say that I want it to be to the origin of this part, this assembly here. So the origin of this assembly here is going to be mated to the path. Now, when it comes time to select the path itself, I'm going to utilize what's called the selection manager. And the selection manager is going to come up when you've got a thin selection box. So over in the selection box over there, in this selection box here for the path, it's thin. It's only one row wide. And that means you can only select one thing. So if I try to pick this, and then pick this, and this, see, it doesn't work. It only lets me pick one. So instead, I'm going to right-click and do selection manager. There's also a button here for selection manager. And what selection manager lets you do is lets you multi-select a group. So I can pick here, 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 and here, and when I hit the green check mark, it's that group that is added as my selection, and it's that group that becomes the path for my path mate. So now when I go to move this part, move this along the conveyor system, you can see here that I'm able to move it along the conveyor system, and I'm able to get these results. Now, you can see it's kind of flopping all over the place, so what I could do is I could create a parallel mate between these two faces, make that parallel, and then we're good with those new shortcut mates, but that's actually not necessary. Within the path mate, you can control what happens with the pitch and with the roll. So I'm gonna say here, edit feature, and then down here in the path mate, I can say the pitch yaw is gonna follow path, and the roll control is gonna be an up vector. I'm gonna do one at a time, just so you can see the impact of both. So first I'll do the roll control, and I'll say the up vector is going to be this face here. And basically what I'm saying is that relative to that face, I always want the model to be upright. All right, so there we go. That took care of one of the items. And then the other item, and this is really cool. Again, if you're using a path mate to simulate a conveyor system, this is really a cool one. I can say I want this path mate to have pitch yaw control to follow path. And Now what we get is we get a really, really nice result here where as it goes along the path, it automatically turns and moves with the path. I'm gonna just do that a little bit slower because I know the video is kind of coming in choppy. I'm backing up here, and you can see that as it rolls around that turn, it just automatically follows the path, stays facing forward. That's gonna be really, really useful when you're doing a path on a conveyor system or something like that. And then so you can see that, I just want to highlight that sketch just so you guys can see. I know it's kind of dull on screen. And then the last one that's there is the option to control the location, to force the location along the path. And this might come into play if you wanted it to be a certain percentage along the path and you were anticipating dynamically changing the path. So for example, here in this path mate, you can see it can go all the way out to the end, it can come all the way back. Maybe what I do is on the path mate, I say edit feature, and I say I want that path constraint to be a percentage along the path. So in other words, I want it to be constrained to be located at exactly 35% of the path. And so now what happens is if I was to make a change to this line, if I was to change the length of this line, which I can do because Instant 3D is turned on, and then rebuild, oops, did I not put that path constraint in proper? Oh, that's weak, it changed. I think I might have just found a bug. See, 35% is where I want it. Now I'm gonna use this to change the distance here. Huh, I think you saw it live on Toby's Tech Talk. We've discovered a bug, possibly. I wonder if that's intentional. Guess you could probably imagine I was thinking that it would jump to the appropriate location. That's pretty interesting. So we'll go here to, we'll go to the login again. I think I should still be logged in. And you know what, just for sake of time, I'm gonna save this, but that's what I'll do. I'll search it and I'll find out, hey, is there an existing issue in this? Maybe I can search path mate, percentage along path, something like that. Finally, the linear coupler mate, another pretty cool one here. And again, I'm gonna use the control drag to get some components involved here. I'm also gonna use the mate command that I demonstrated before. So here, I'm just gonna grab a door from one of the rooms in the house, the second door here. I like to just kind of get them close to the appropriate position, not necessarily completely locked in place, but just kind of close. And then I'm going to select a face, hold control, select another face, let go of control, mate them together. No need to hit a check mark or anything. Those quick mates are so awesome. Pick this face, put those two at a distance of 40. All right, and we'll start that guy right there. And then I will kind of do the same thing here. So I'll pick this face, hold control, pick this face, let go of control, coincident. Now it does mate to closest, so if, for example, I had something like this where it was upside down, you know, then I might not quite get the results that I want. You see how it dropped it in there on the wrong side? So, you know, it does mate to closest. So just keep that in mind when you're positioning your components. Position them in a way that they can move into closest, and if they're not, just move them first, then mate them. It'll save you so much time not having to go into that mate dialogue. So now these two, gonna mate them at a distance, and I'll make that 60. Okay, and we've got our setup now for our linear coupler. And so with this linear coupler, you know, they don't necessarily have to be moving perpendicular to one another. They could certainly be parallel. In fact, I'll show that as well at the end here. But basically the gist of it is that as you move one part, the other part moves in a linear direction. So to create this mate, I'll do S key mate, advanced mates, and then I'll do linear coupler. And when I do linear coupler, I'll say here that the entity to mate is going to be this edge of this part. The entity to mate is going to be this edge of this part. And the ratio is going to be 1:1. That shouldn't be over-defining. And so you can see here that the ratio is 1:1. They're moving directly through one another with that 1:1 ratio. And then, of course, I could edit that linear coupler and adjust that ratio. So I could make this maybe a 1:1.5 or to, let me make a 0.25 just to really truly illustrate what's going on. And so you can see that now this one has to move much further as the other one moves through. Okay, so a question came in here, with linear coupler, can you constrain their movement to make sure that they never intersect? Well, that's a great question, Keith, and to do that, you probably want to use a limit mate. So let's take a look at that one next. So I'm going to say mate here, and this mate is going to be advanced mates limit mate, so limit distance mate in this case, and it's going to be between these two faces. So that's going to be a limit mate between those two faces, and we'll say that the default is going to be 12 inches. Let me bump that down just a little bit. 11 inches, and because that looks like that's just about where they're intersecting. Maybe I can make it even 10. And 10 is going to also be the max, and then the minimum is going to be 0. And so now what happens is, as I move this guy, he can only move within that range, and we can keep those components a little bit more limited. Now, what you're going to see is that in SolidWorks 2015, there's going to be more functionality there. If you go to YouTube or anything, Keith, and you look at the what's new with 2015 they showed at SolidWorks World, they did show some really cool stuff with taking components and limiting their distance, but also but limiting their distance not based on a value that you enter, but instead limiting it in combination with a width mate. So I know I'm not doing a very good job explaining it, but like I said, if you can look up what's new or what will be new in 2015, you'll see some of that functionality. So just want to look at some of the questions here as we start to wrap things up. Let's see here. Parallel faces of one, it'll find it on Mackie with the width mate. That's pretty cool, Gary. I'll have to try that. Does it also work with spline fit spline sketch? Okay, so this looks like this was a question on the path mate. Does it work with spline fit spline? Let me just try it real quick, Roger, and we'll find out together. So we go here, sketch, we go spline, exit sketch, and now we're going to go S key, mate, advanced mates, path. The point is going to be this point here, and the path is going to be this spline, and it looks like we're golden there. And we can move that along and it stays right on that spline. Yep. So those are some of the mates. I mean, with limit, you know, I went through that kind of quick at the end, but just to review that, with the limit mate, what we can do is we can establish a limit on, in my case it was distance, but you can also establish a limit on angle, like an angle mate. You indicate here what you want the default distance to be, kind of the resting distance. You indicate here what you want the max distance to be and what you want the min distance to be. So if we come in here and we do, let's say, 5, then that's going to become, that's going to become kind of the resting distance or the distance that's displayed on screen, but it'll still have a max distance of 10 and a min distance of 0. Another question on the path mate came in. Can we do path mate on a full circle? Again, let's find out together. There's our circle. Let's edit our path mate here. And we're going to say it's going to be not on the spline, but on the circle. And yes, indeed, Tom, it looks like it can be. Okay, Don, yep, see you, Don. I know a couple people have to cut out. And that percentage, Tom, it locks it to a certain position along the path. I think that probably would be something you would just do temporarily. But yeah, the percentage just locks it to a certain position along the path. Whoops. Did not mean to do that. I'll just minimize this. So with that, if there's any other questions that are coming in, that does bring us up to the 1 o'clock hour. Like I mentioned, this is part one of what will probably end up being a three-part series on advanced mates. We went through some of the advanced mates. I hope you guys can find some good uses for those, or at least you have an idea on how to use those now. Certainly path mate is probably the one that I use the most as far as kind of using as a workaround. Like if you had a slotted hole or something and you wanted to keep the path mate, you wanted to keep your slot running along that entire weird slotted hole like a cam, that would be a great way to do it. So if there are any additional questions, feel free to field them over in the question and answer block. Otherwise, I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Don, thank you for tuning in. See you later. Jason, thank you. Glad that it was informative. Of course, if you have any other questions, email SWTech. You can always, when you email us, you can say, hey, this would be a good idea for an upcoming Toby's Tech Talk, and we'll definitely get that into the rotation. I'm always looking for topics. Craig, great seeing you. Thank you. Victor, thank you for coming in. Tony, wonderful. Thank you. Paul, Steven, thank you for coming in. Great seeing you guys. Joe, glad you can make it. Good to hear from you again. Tom, yep, Tom Smith, see you tomorrow. Mike, thank you very much for coming in. Yep, mechanical mates, it's what we'll do next month. Gary, put another shrimp on the bobby, right? See you next month. Ken, thank you very much for tuning in. Great to see you in here again. Always good to see all you guys. And like I said, if you do have any questions, email me. If you have suggestions, let me know. Be happy to incorporate them into the next tech talk. Hope you guys found this info useful. Scott, thank you. Thank you very much. Nate, I will definitely be doing some slapping. Okay. Where is zero? Okay, question came in from Tom here. Maybe we'll talk about this one tomorrow, Tom. We can probably beat this up a little more. I'm not exactly sure where that percentage is that you're referring to. Okay, cool. Yeah. Oh, good. Andy came in for the what's new updates. Good. I'm glad that went well. That was with Stefan, I believe. He's one of the best. Tell you what, he's an amazing instructor. But thank you very much for that shout out. For my personal email, it's tschnars@prismeng.com. But you can email that SWTech and it'll get to me, Eric, and then I'll email you back, and then you'll have my direct email. But thank you for tuning in. Thanks for the good questions. And looks like that's going to pretty much wrap it up. If there's any other questions, let me know. Otherwise, I think that's probably going to be where we're going to end the webinar. And thank you all for tuning in. And I'll see you guys next month. Bye-bye.